part two of this three-part series of Architecture All Access. Longtime AI evangelist, educator, author, and Intel fellow, Andres Rodriguez, continues with an explanation of different computer architectures and the trade-offs for implementing cutting-edge artificial intelligence systems. This is Architecture All Access.
We left off the last video with the question of which hardware is best for neural networks. Traditionally, CPUs offered the most flexibility and ASICs offered the highest performance per power for a specific workload. Today, modern processors are much more heterogeneous with both general purpose compute and dedicated ASIC-like compute. There are some features adopted across processors targeting training. Such processors include Intel Sapphire Rapids, Intel Ponte Vecchio, and Intel Habana Gaudi, and processors from Google, NVIDIA, AMD, Cerebra Systems, and others. These common features include BFLOR 16, a relatively new 16-bit floating point format introduced by Google, high bandwidth memory, or HBM, and dedicated MAC-based systolic arrays. All these processors also support a variety of other numerical precisions, and each also has their unique features. MAC-based systolic arrays or data flow architectures have MACs, or multiply and accumulate, connected in a mesh pattern. They provide high compute per silicon area and are used for matrix multiplications. Data flow architectures are common in dedicated compute processors and in modern GPUs, and were recently added to some CPUs, such as Sapphire Rapids. Data flow processors work best with regular, predictable memory access patterns. Using systolic architectures near peak performance requires a mature compiler or program that considers the memory hierarchy of the architecture. A minor mismatch from memory access to the systolic data flow can lead to significant performance degradation. So let's talk about some of the similarities and differences between CPUs and GPUs, which are the main hardware currently used for deep learning. We have already discussed data flow architectures available in some GPUs and CPUs. Both CPUs and GPUs also have specialized vector instructions that can simultaneously operate on multiple data, known as SIMD or single instruction multiple data for CPUs, and SIMT or single instruction multiple threads for GPUs. A server CPU typically has faster but fewer cores compared to a GPU. It may be better for complex workloads. The parallelizable core can benefit from the many CPU cores, the SIMD instructions, or if available, the systolic arrays. And the serial core can benefit from the single core higher frequency performance. A CPU provides maximum flexibility and is typically simpler to program than other hardware. This flexibility, however, comes at the expense of higher power consumption. Embarrassingly parallel workloads, where little effort is needed to separate the problem into parallel tasks, with predictable memory access patterns, do not require many of the capabilities of the CPU. And a more dedicated processor should provide higher performance per watt. However, as deep learning workloads become more complex, the features of the CPU can become more advantageous. GPUs are designed for embarrassingly parallel tasks, initially targeting image manipulations by simultaneously applying an operator to a group of pixels, and later targeting deep learning matrix multiplications. A key difference between a CPU and a GPU core is that the CPU core can execute instructions independently of the other cores. A GPU core has to execute the same instruction as the other cores within its group. While the CPU cores may provide more flexibility than the GPU cores, the GPU cores can provide higher energy efficiency. These differences are the reason that GPUs are commonly used for training and CPUs for inference. Inference has less parallelism and can benefit more from the higher CPU frequency. In addition, the ability to run an inference workload on a single CPU core and leave the other cores available for other applications is valuable for many end users. GPUs can typically offer higher training performance at lower energy for highly parallelizable training workloads. Dedicated AI processors have a large dedicated compute to general compute ratio. They're ideal for workloads with predictable memory access patterns, as they can provide the highest performance per power when the data is properly pipelined to the compute. Another key advantage is the shorter design to production window. As we discussed in our Architecture All Access FPGA episode, FPGAs are reconfigurable hardware beneficial to adapt to newer workloads that require different hardware characteristics. Microsoft has been using FPGAs for AI for several years and provides FPGA AI acceleration in Azure to their end customers. Intel and other FPGA vendors offer libraries to facilitate using their FPGAs for AI. One challenge with FPGAs is the long compilation time, several minutes to hours, to reconfigure the hardware. So let's go back to the question, which hardware is best for neural networks? While there are multiple different types of processors, they're becoming more heterogeneous and are actually beginning to share more common characteristics. Given the growing complexity of neural networks, the right processor is one that balances general purpose compute and specialized compute and scales well across nodes. Different hardware vendors are making different bets on what is this right balance to best support today's and future workloads. In general, if you're working with a variety of complex workloads or as a starting point when exploring an AI solution, a more general purpose processor like a CPU, especially one with built-in acceleration, is likely the best choice. If you require the highest performance per power with predictable memory access patterns, or you require something more specialized, then a dedicated accelerator can likely be the best choice. And of course, a vital consideration is that the processor is simple to program and to use. Software is imperative to unlock the performance of these processors and systems. We need data scientists, software engineers, and hardware architects to collaborate designing deep learning systems to continue the current pace of innovation. I want to thank you for your interest in learning more about AI hardware. To learn more about software, be sure to watch Architecture All Access AI Software Part 3, where my good friend and excellent colleague, Huma Abidi, explains all about AI software.